Hello, everybody. I'm Fransiska Malfait, and I'm a clinical geneticist at the Ghent University and Ghent University Hospital in Belgium. And I would like to talk to you about the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome dermatosparaxis type. This condition was first reported in cattle in Belgium. And affected animals were noted to have a loose and extremely fragile skin, resulting in large skin lacerations during delivery or early in life, which subsequently led to infections and premature death. Hence the name dermatosparaxis, which is Greek for tearing of the skin. Dermatosparaxis was later also found in sheep, dogs, and in cats. And early ultrastructural studies showed alterations in the skin of these animals with loosely packed, thin, and twisted ribbon-like collagen fibers that displayed a typical hieroglyphic aspect on cross-sections, pointing actually towards impaired collagen biosynthesis and fibrillogenesis. Although animal dermatosparaxis was the first recognized collagen disorder, it took more than 20 years to confirm the existence of a human counterpart for this disorder. In 1992, three infants were reported with clinical signs resembling dermatosparaxis as seen in the animals. And ultrastructural studies of their skin demonstrated the same hieroglyphic pattern of collagen fibrils as that observed in the dermatosparactic animals. Biochemical studies in animals and in humans provided evidence for a defect of the conversion of a precursor molecule of collagen called procollagen to its mature form. Indeed, production of collagen type 1, it starts with the synthesis of a precursor molecule or a precursor chain, which is called a procollagen chain. Three procollagen chains typically assemble in a zipper-like fashion to form this triple helix with extensions at both ends, which we call propeptides. And these propeptides need to be cut, they need to be cleaved off, as this is necessary to allow assembly of the collagen molecules into highly ordered collagen fibrils and fibers, as you can see here on this electron microscopy of the skin. Cleavage of one of these ends, the N-propeptide or aminopropeptide, is done by a specific protein, which is called procollagen N proteinase or ADAMTS2. And as you can see, it's like a kind of scissors that cuts off the amino terminal propeptide of type 1 procollagen. If this ADAMTS2 is absent or not functioning very well, that is, if the scissors are not there, due to genetic defects in the gene that codes for the production of this protein, the aminopropeptide of type 1 collagen will not be cleaved off, and it will be incorporated into the mature collagen fibrils. And this incorporation of these immature collagen fibrils will completely disturb the collagen fibril architecture, leading to this hieroglyphic pattern. Dermatosparaxis type of EDS is truly a rare type of EDS. To date, only 15 patients from 14 different families have been reported in medical literature, 11 males and 4 females. And clinical follow-up into adolescence and early adulthood has only been reported for 2 patients. 9 out of 15 of the reported patients had a preterm birth, often with premature rupture of the membranes, and the mean gestational age was 34 weeks, 4 days. Most of the children had quite a large umbilical hernia at birth, and some even had a friable or ruptured umbilical cord. One of the main characteristics, also usually obvious from birth, is the presence of excessive skin fragility and often also a sagging, somewhat redundant skin. Most children also have quite a recognizable facial appearance with protuberant eyes, puffy eyelids, as you can see here, excessive periorbital skin, large fontanelles, hypoplastic chin, and bluish sclerae. And then in some infants, perinatal complications have been reported and include cerebral hemorrhage, congenital skull fractures, a pneumothorax, or a hydronephrosis. Like I said, the skin is usually and in most patients very fragile and also hyperextensible, like we can see in other types of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. But this hyperextensibility can be so severe that the skin even becomes more lax and can hang in skin folds, especially, for instance, around the hands and the feet. The skin is typically very soft and doughy to the touch and can also be thin and somewhat translucent, as you can appreciate here from this picture. Often there is also increased wrinkling of the hand palms, and most children also suffer from easy bruising or even more severe from subcutaneous hematomas, as you can see here. But as you can also appreciate from these pictures from four different children that we have seen here in Belgium, is that the severity of the skin manifestations can also vary quite a lot. And we see spectrum ranging from quite severe to more mildly affected patients. We also usually see postnatal growth restriction with non-rhizomelic shortening of the limbs and usually quite plump hands and feet. And in some children, initially there was a suspicion of achondroplasia because of the short stature and the shortening of the limbs. Joint hypermobility is present, but it can be rather mild during childhood, and then it seems to be become a little bit more progressive as the patient gets older. And there can also be delay in gross motor development. We have seen some fractures in patients, actually in 4 out of 15, including the skull fractures, as I have already discussed. And then we can also see some other skeletal anomalies, such as Wormian bones, delayed ossification of the cranial vault, and delayed bone age. So also later in life, the patients can have a somewhat typical facial appearance. We usually see a blue discoloration of the white of the eye or blue sclerae, somewhat small chin, epicanthic folds at the eyes, gingival hyperplasia, and then also some abnormalities of the teeth, such as dental lamina cysts, but other anomalies have been described, such as agenesis of permanent teeth, tooth discoloration, abnormal morphology of the molars, and animal attrition of the deciduous teeth. Again, here you can see the spectrum of facial appearance that we see across the different patients that, that we have seen. And then there can be other signs and symptoms, congenital or progressive myopia, sometimes in association with astigmatism, has been noted. Some patients have had bleeding problems ranging from mild gum and nosebleeds to more severe internal hemorrhage, and sometimes even, as I explained, congenital cerebral hemorrhage. Aortic dilatation or rupture has not been reported so far. And then there have also been some internal complications, including a rupture of a diaphragm, bladder diverticula with bladder rupture, and rectal prolapse with profuse bleeding. So in these 15 patients, so far, 8 different genetic defects have been reported in ADAMTS2, and there's actually one founder mutation, an Ashkenazi founder mutation, and the molecular basis, the molecular diagnosis is also based on sequencing of the ADAMTS2 gene. Electron microscopy of the skin showing the hieroglyphic pattern of the collagens can also help in the diagnosis, but since it's not completely specific, as it can be overlapping with what we also see, for instance, in arthrochalasia type of EDS, it cannot actually confirm the diagnosis with 100% certitude. So one of the striking things is that there is a lot of phenotypic phenotypic difference with what we see in arthrocalasia type of EDS, although in the arthrocalasia type of EDS, there is also a problem with cleaving of the amino terminal propeptide of type 1 procollagen. And this could be because ADAMTS2, the molecule, is also involved in processing of other proteins, for instance, processing of the amino terminal propeptide of type 5 collagen, of type 3 collagen. Other cleavage sites for ADAMTS2 have been identified in at other locations in type 1 collagen, and even in other collagens such as collagen 14, collagen 6, and other extracellular matrix proteins. And these could all contribute. I mean, if there's abnormal cleavage of these proteins, this could contribute to the phenotype and to the severity of the disease. However, further studies are needed to know to what extent they contribute. There is a lot of unknowns in dermatosparaxis type of Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. We don't know the exact prevalence. It has been identified in 15 patients or reported in 15 patients, but this could be an underdiagnosed disorder. We don't know the natural history later in life. We don't know, for instance, what is the pregnancy risk? Is fertility normal in affected individuals? There's no study on the impact of the disease on daily functioning and quality of life. We don't know the exact correlations between the genetic defect and the severity and the complications in the specific patients, to what extent abnormal cleavage of different substrate of ADAMTS2 contributes to the clinical manifestations. And most importantly, what is the best strategy for management? And can we also find treatments such as enzyme replacement therapy, for instance? No studies have been done. So there are a lot of opportunities for future research, such as epidemiological studies, quality of life studies. And then also there is, for instance, a mouse model available for further study that also lacks the ADAMTS2 due to a mutation in its gene. So studies in this model, but also, for instance, in other animal models such as zebrafish models, could also be very important to gain insight into the pathogenesis of this condition and also to perform preclinical studies. So with this, I would like to thank you for your attention. I have listed here a selection of interesting articles on the topic, and I would be happy to answer any questions that you may have. Thank you very much.